Philippians chapter 3. I'll be reading from the NIV. It'll come up on the screens, I think, but it's up. And if you've got your Bibles, it'd be great to look on as well. Philippians chapter 3. Finally, my brothers, rejoice in the Lord. It is no trouble for me to write the same things again to you, and it is a safeguard for you. Watch out for those dogs, those men who do evil, those mutilators of the flesh. For it is we who are the circumcision, we who worship by the Spirit of God, who glory in Christ Jesus, and who put no confidence in the flesh, though I myself have reasons for such confidence. If anyone else thinks he has reasons to put confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, in regard to the law, a Pharisee. As for zeal, persecuting the church. As for legalistic righteousness, faultless. But whatever was to my profit, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them rubbish, that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from God and is by faith. I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of sharing in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, and so somehow to attain to the resurrection from the dead. Not that I've already obtained all this or have already been made perfect, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ took hold of me. Brothers, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining towards what is ahead, I press on towards the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. All of us who are mature should take such a view of things. And if on some point you think differently, that too God will make clear to you. Only let us live up to what we have already attained. Join with others in following my example, brothers, and take note of those who live according to the pattern we gave you. For as I have often said before and now say again, even with tears, many live as enemies of the cross of Christ. Their destiny is destruction, their God is their stomach. Their mind is on earthly things, but our citizenship is in heaven, and we eagerly await a Saviour from there, the Lord Jesus Christ, who by the power that enables him to bring everything under his control, will transform our lowly bodies so that they will be like his glorious body.
It's good to be on the coast. If my church back home saw the logo that said Chandler on the coast, I would get quite making fun of. So I'm praying no one Twitters that. If we were honest, and I don't know that we can be, but if we were honest, when it comes to growing in a depth of Jesus Christ, most of us will feel far more like King David than we will the Apostle Paul. And here's what I mean by that. King David, when you read King David, he'll say, oh, how wonderful it is that you're aware of me, that you know who I am, that you are near to me. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I? And it seems like he's got this deep, rich, beautiful intimacy with God. And then if you turn the page, like literally if you turn the page, he'll say, how long, O Lord, will you forsake me? And where are you? And why have you hid yourself from me? And where are you? And he almost sounds a little bit bipolar schizophrenic. And I think if we were honest, most of us would talk about our own spiritual formation as having these seasons where God is very close and very near and very beautiful and very dear to our hearts. And then these other times where we wonder where he is and have a hard time finding him and seeking him and walking with him. And then there's the Apostle Paul, who in his writings comes across like Superman. And so they come to Paul and they say, if you don't stop preaching Jesus Christ, we're going to kill you. And he goes, to die is gain. And they come to him and say, okay, if you don't quit preaching Jesus Christ, we'll torture you. And then he goes, well, okay, the present sufferings are not worthy to be compared to the future glory. I don't care. And then they go, okay, well, if you won't quit preaching Jesus Christ, we'll put you in prison. And then he simply says, well, give me the hymnal because I'll sing praises while I'm down there. And then he'll go, okay, well, we'll just leave you alone. And he says, well, to live is Christ. And so Paul comes across like Superman. David comes across a little schizophrenic. And I think the bulk of us would say, I kind of land more with David than I do Paul on this one. And so what I want to do is I want to take us to Paul and show you that he's not all the Superman that we've made him out to be, and that he's very honest about his own pursuit of Jesus Christ, how he has worked on deepening his relationship with Jesus Christ. And then my hope is we can take a cue from him and see what God wants to do in us. So the first part of Philippians chapter 3 is interesting because all he's doing is he's unpacking why we should follow Jesus Christ. He's not going to get into the how yet. He's simply going to get into the why we should follow Jesus Christ. And then after he sets that up, he's going to get into the how. And so let's look at the why very quickly, because what I want to do is get to the how. Let's look at it. Finally, my brothers, rejoice in the Lord. To write the same things to you is no trouble for me and is safe for you. Look out for the dogs. Look out for the evildoers. Look out for those who mutilate the flesh. For we are the real circumcision, who worship the Spirit of God and glory in Christ Jesus and put no confidence in the flesh. Now, this is really a beautiful text. He is combating or undermining the Judaizers who are saying, if you want to follow Jesus Christ, you must first become a Jew. Or really what they're unpacking is that you must obey the law to the nth of the law if you want to be a follower of Jesus Christ. So it's not just the cross of Christ, but it's the cross of Christ and these other things that are necessary if you're going to know and walk with Jesus Christ. And I don't know if you noticed, but he calls them dogs, mutilators of the flesh. He really goes after them here. And then look at what he says. I have for years loved this next batch of scriptures. Though I myself have reason for confidence in the flesh also, if anyone else thinks he has reason for confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, as to the law a Pharisee, as to zeal a persecutor of the church, as to righteousness under the law, blameless. So if I could pull that into 2009, here's all he said. I was born in the church, literally born in the church. My mother gave birth to me. I came out on the altar. The minister picked me up, smacked my bottom, and I said, Jesus! They immediately baptized me as a two-minute-old baby. I have followed the law ever since then. I have not made a mistake. I have never been drunk. I have never gotten angry. I have Sunday school pins that go all the way down to the floor. He is simply outlining the moral standards of his day and has basically said, I have crushed these. I have done better than anyone else has done at these. In fact, when it comes to the law, I am blameless. So like if this was me, I would have to go, I really stunk at the law and I never really came to church and I've made all the mistakes and actually I took certain things that were called sinful and I just tried to see how far I could actually push those things. And Paul had a very different background and a very different upbringing. He was extremely moral, extremely externally righteous. He was the consummate church kid. We would look at him and say, I wish little Johnny, my little Johnny, would be like Paul. So that makes his next line very, very interesting. Verse 7. But whatever gain I had, whatever good came from all that goodness, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ. Indeed, I count everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of Jesus Christ my Lord. For his sake I have suffered the loss of all things and count them rubbish, excrement.
I count them as dung. Do I need to give you another word? I hope not. I only have one left in my head. It's not appropriate. So now keep in mind what we're talking about here. Paul just said, I have done all these righteous things. I have done all these religious things. I have done all these moral things. And I count them as rubbish next to the surpassing greatness of knowing Jesus Christ, my Lord. So here's what he's saying. If you get religion and you get morality, but you don't get Jesus, you've made a horrible trade. So putting on some external sense of religion without a transformed heart that knows Jesus Christ is a horrible, sad, maybe even wicked trade. To be conformed to a pattern of religion, but not be transformed by the Spirit of God, is a horrible place to find one's life playing out. Let's keep reading. I count everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake I have suffered the loss of all things, and I count them as rubbish, in order that I might gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends on faith. Oh, that I might know him and the power of his resurrection, and may share in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that by any means possible I might attain the resurrection from the dead. So this first part of three, he's simply unpacking, this is why I want to know him. This is why I want to chase him. This is what, because he is better than religion. He is better than morality. He is better than religious title. He is better than all of life. In fact, I count all things, everything, good things, bad things, I count all things as rubbish next to the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. Now, this starts to bring Paul's life in focus, all right? Because he lives in such a way that reveals that he really believes this. That Christ is enough for him. Like, there are some maddening moments in the life of Paul. Like, he goes through Ephesus, and the elders at Ephesus go, the Holy Spirit has told us that if you go into Rome, they're going to arrest you, and they're going to kill you. And do you remember his response? Yeah, he told me that too. And then he goes on in. I mean, he believes this. I count everything a loss compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Jesus Christ, my Lord. Yeah. All right. So I didn't want to hang out on the why. I think you have great teaching here, and so you know the why. What I wanted to talk, and really what they asked me to talk to you about, was the how. Because I think predominantly most of us would say, I want to grow deeper with Jesus Christ. I want a more rich experience with God. I want a more rich relationship. I want a greater understanding. I think the bulk of us would say that. And so the next part, and really the second half of chapter 3, is about how he pursued this great God, and it's there that we'll spend our time tonight. So let's look at it. We'll pick it up in verse 12. Not that I have already obtained this or am already perfect, but I press on to make it my own because Christ Jesus has made me his own. Brothers, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but one thing I do, and I'll stop there. You're going to find out that Paul is definitely a preacher because he's going to say one thing I do and then list out six things. And so I want to start here at a very interesting little moment. The Apostle Paul is well beyond where you and I are and more than likely will ever be. I'll explain it this way. If you'll read the book of Acts, like when people get sick at the village church, our elders lay hands on them and we ask God to heal them. The Apostle Paul walked by people and said, quit being sick, get up. And they simply got up. So that's different, right? Like we lay hands on and go, God, please heal. He walks up and says, your disease is gone. That's different. In the book of Acts, you find that the Apostle Paul's handkerchief and apron were healing people. Like somebody would come in and they would steal his hanky and then they would go throw it on someone. It's where we get the phrase holy snot. And they would be healed of their diseases. We find out that this man has been in what's called the third heaven. I have no idea where that is, but he went there. He is responsible for 75% of the New Testament. If anyone knows what it's like to walk deeply and passionately with Jesus Christ, it's the Apostle Paul. And what did he just say? Not that I have already obtained all these things or have been made perfect. See, here's a unique feature of the Apostle Paul. As well as he knows God, and as passionately as he knows God, there is still this level of holy discontentment in his life. I want more. He's already said it in what we've already read, where he says, oh, that I might know him, and that I might have some fellowship in his sufferings, that I might somehow gain. He has this holy discontentment that even after all he has experienced in Christ, he wants more. And I think one of the things that's missing in evangelicalism, not just in Australia and in America, but really all over the place, is we seem to have misplaced our holy discontentment. We are far too easily satisfied where we are. We set really peddly, weak goals. Like, I'd like to not do this behavior anymore. Or I would like it if I could just be a little bit more disciplined in this area. And we have these little peddly goals that we can reach rather easily, and then in the end become content with what we know and where we are. So Paul's saying here, if you want to know how I pursue Jesus Christ, if you want to know how I chase after this surpassing greatness, here's what I would say: develop a holy discontentment with where you are. So here's our question, because that's a lot of ambiguity, isn't it? Develop a holy discontentment. How do we develop a holy discontentment with where we are spiritually? I can give you just a couple of things. I think one of the games that we play, that's a really bad game, is we judge our spirituality not by comparing ourselves to the holiness of God, but by looking around at others. And so we go, I'm doing really well because look at him. I'm doing really well because I'm not her. Well, there's some flaws in your reasoning. You should be able to find someone that you're better than, or you're probably in jail. I mean, you should be able to look around and go, at least I'm not that guy. But God does not see you or judge you in that vein. God does not put you next to a friend and go, I'll take that one. That's not how it works. And so what we do is we let the scriptures, and we look at the holiness of God, and we go, I'm not there. Not, I'll look at you, I'll look at you, I'll look at you, I'm better than you, so I must be doing well. No. We look at the holiness of God, we see how we fall short, and we repent and we pursue. Yeah, that's the first way. The second way I think you develop holy discontentment is you surround yourself with people who are far godlier than you are. Specifically, maybe in areas that you're really weak. So if you don't know the Bible well, you should probably run with people who know the Bible very, very well. If you're afraid to share your faith, you should probably hook up with those who are ferocious about sharing their faith. So in college, I was always nervous about just shotgunning evangelism. Like, I could always build relationships with people and talk. And so I hung out with a street evangelist named Jose Muniz, who was a little crazy. And I don't mean that like he had a weird personality. I mean, literally, he might be crazy. But he would just, he'd fearlessly share the gospel with anyone. And so the first time I ever sat down with him, we went to this sandwich shop, and he ordered like a little tuna sandwich. It was like a little 6-inch tuna sandwich. And the girl was making his sandwich, and he says, you think that sandwich can feed 5,000 people? And she was like, no, sir. We have one that, it feeds 30 people up here. And then there's another one that might go 45 people, but we don't make a sandwich that could feed 5,000 people. And of course, we all know where he's going, right? And so he's like, oh, then you don't know my God. Because my God took two little scoops of fish, some loaves of bread, and he fed 5,000 people. Then he just started sharing the gospel with her. Just went and sat by myself. Ate my sandwich. I mean, he could take any conversation and get it to the gospel. I mean, it was an art how well he did it. You know, I mean, he would just walk up and start talking to somebody about their shoes, and next thing you know, he had tied that somehow to how beautiful are the feet of those who deliver good news. Do you like these shoes? These shoes have brought good news to you. And then he was talking, I mean, it was unreal how well he could do that. You know, I was always looking for the perfect end. You know, I was always looking for somebody to go, all I got left is my soul and nobody wants it. And then I could go, actually, I know someone who wants it. Whereas Jose didn't wait, he just figured it out. And so I just spent all the time in the world with him because he made me be frustrated with myself spiritually. Now at the end, I don't have the gift of evangelism like he has the gift of evangelism, but I have been commanded in Scripture, regardless of whether or not I have the gift, to do the work of an evangelist. And so I wanted to be around him because he made me discontent with where I was spiritually. I wanted to grow. It made me want to grow. While at the same time trying to figure out and honor where my part in the body is, it was a beautiful thing to be pressed by him. So I think you compare yourself with the holiness of God and you surround yourself with godly people. I've got two more things here. You know the promises in the Bible about your maturity? My son right now is, he's probably about this tall. And that's a good thing because he's three. And so he's actually in like the 90th percentile in height. So I'm 6'5". I have no idea. That's feet. I have no idea what I am in meters. We're American. We're sticking to that system. We don't care what the rest of the world does. We don't care how difficult it is to communicate and whatever, but we're sticking to it. And he's just a little guy like that. And he's really, it's good for his age. But if he's still that tall when he's 14, we'll probably need to take him to a doctor or something. And because he's supposed to grow. And here's the thing. I'm not going to be able to see him. Like, I could stare at him all I want. And I'm never going to watch him grow. Like, I won't be able to just stare at him and go, oh, there it is. There he is. He grew. He grew like a quarter of an inch. Did you see that? Anybody see that? So he's going to grow slow, but he is going to grow. And we are going to be able to measure that. We are going to be able to say, wow, look how tall he is. Look, his pants, they don't fit him anymore. We need to buy him new pants. He is going to use a word that we're going to go, wow, when did he start using that word correctly? He is going to come down the stairs. And for those of you who have kids, it's like all of a sudden you see him and you're like, wow, when did that happen? If you have small kids, you measure it by how high you have to put stuff you don't want them to break. So you move it up, move it up, move it up, move it up, start spanking them. Some of you just started beating them down here, all right? We waited. And so it is measurable, but we need to know that God has said, I have begun a good work in you. I'm going to be faithful to complete it. Progressive sanctification should be a part of all of our lives. We should be growing in our knowledge of the Lord, our knowledge of the Word, and in our relationship with Christ. Where we are not, something needs to be dealt with. And so knowing the promises of God that he has promised to grow you is paramount. And then the last thing, I think, in regards to really developing discontentment in your heart, holy discontentment, not sinful discontentment, is to really do a good job of introspection. Like to know who you are, to know what's actually going on in your heart, to pay attention to your soul, to pay attention where you have jealousy, where you have anger, where you have unresolved conflict, where you have introspection. Like Paul clearly says, no one can overlook the painful work of self-examination. Like all of those things combined will create in us a discontentment while at the same time a hope that he who started this will be faithful to complete it. So Paul says, do you want to know how I press into the surpassing greatness of Jesus Christ? I'm insatiable, and I'm discontented with where I am. Not in an unhealthy way, but in a healthy way. Holy discontentment. And the Bible is saturated with men who fell into this. Like when King David says, as the deer pants for the water, so my soul longs for you. That's not kitschy and cute. That doesn't belong on a t-shirt or a coffee cup. That is a painful, angst-filled, I want more of you. Is it not? Psalm 27, when he says, one thing I ask and all that I seek is that I might dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to seek him in his temple. That's not cute and kitschy. He's in pain. I want more of you. I want to know more about you. I want to, holy discontentment. It's a beautiful thing that must be cultivated. But he doesn't stop there. Remember, he says, I have one thing to say, and he's going to say it six times in different ways. Not that I've already obtained this or I'm already perfect, but I press on to make it my own because Jesus Christ has made me his own. Brothers, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but one thing I do, and then he's going to start the rest of the list. Holy discontentment in this next one. Forgetting what is behind. Now, we know that he can't mean everything that it's behind because, you know, the Bible says to remember the things that the Lord does. And then you've got Hebrews 11 that's pretty much just a roll call of faith, right? So I think if you'll continue to read Scripture, what you'll find out he means is this. If you dwell too long on former successes, then you have a tendency to become smug, pretentious. So it's why he would say in 1 Corinthians, take heed, you stand, lest you fall. So we don't look at yesterday's successes to sustain us into tomorrow. But he says, not only do I forget what is behind, maybe in the successes, but I also want to forget what is behind on the failures, but only in so much as it paralyzes me. So I have found that there are those who don't want to hand things over to the Lord and don't want to surrender things to the Lord because they've tried before and then they failed. And so now they're paralyzed with fear and they're going, oh, this doesn't work for me and God doesn't love me. And then, and at some point, you can't let past failures paralyze you because that's just as God belittling. To say the cross doesn't work for me is just as God belittling as the person that says, I don't need the cross. And I think the perfect example of forgetting what is behind and still using your failures to the glory of God is in 1 Timothy where Paul says, I was a blasphemer and a violent man persecuting the church of Christ, but God, so that his rich patience might be known through the ages, showed mercy on me, the chief of sinners. So we forget what is behind. We don't live on yesterday's successes, and we don't let yesterday's failures paralyze us. And then this is the next piece. And I heard this piece a bunch when they were asking you to talk about how you grow into the Lord. Forgetting what is behind, and I love this word, straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on towards the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Let those of us who are mature think this way. So forgetting what is behind and straining for what lies ahead. My great fear in evangelicalism, specifically in the States, is that where there's an understanding that God saves, there tends to be a laziness when it comes to sanctification. So that since justification is the work of God alone, then sanctification will be me sitting on the couch waiting for God to change me. And so there's very few people who make war against their sin and make war against their flesh. But he's using a word here, I strain, I fight, and you'll find this kind of language throughout all Paul's letters where he says, I train yourself for godliness. Train, the Greek word gymnopsia, means to sweat yourself to godliness, to fight for it, to cling for it, to work for it, not to work for godliness, but to strain for it, to put ourselves under the waterfall of God's grace that he might transform us. It's a making war against the flesh. So when I'm walking with new believers and we're working on discipleship and discipline, one of the things I always want to teach them is everybody that I know who says they love Jesus Christ knows they should read the Bible. The problem is nobody ever answers the question, when am I going to read the Bible? And where and how am I going to read the Bible? When am I going to pray? And how and why am I going to pray? And so since they never answer those questions, there are men and women that just go, I need to read the Bible. And so they get up on Monday and they go, I need to spend some time with the Lord. And then just things fill their day and they don't. And they go to bed Monday night and they're just like, oh, God, tomorrow, love you so much. You know I love you. Thank you. Tomorrow I'm going to get up and read the word, and then tomorrow they get up, and then the day just kind of progresses, and then they go to bed on Tuesday night and go, Lord, I love you, forgive me, I just apologize for that, tomorrow's the day. In fact, I'll set the alarm a little bit earlier, and I'm going to get up, and you and me, I'm going to read the entire book of Leviticus tomorrow morning at 6 a.m., and so I get up, just help me get up in the morning, I love you so, okay, snooze, go, and there's no real plan. It's like somehow planning to pursue God has become ungodly, or dry. That's the one, that's the stupid word people use. That somehow me saying, this is when I'm going to sit down and pursue the Lord, is somehow dry, cold, and ineffective, as opposed to you saying you're going to but never doing it. Straining is about discipline, about beating our body and making it our slaves. It's about the relentless, ferocious pursuit of the things of God. The things of God. Straining for what is ahead. All right, let's finish this thing up. Only, if you remember, we left off at, let those of us who are mature think this way, and if in anything you think otherwise, God will reveal that to you also. I love this verse. Only, let us hold true to what we have already attained. Okay, let me do this as an American. You do not need new revelation from God. You need to be obedient to what he's already shown you. So I think it seems like all over the world, people are waiting for some sort of new idea, new methodology, new revelation, new style, new to make things click, make things work. What you need to be is obedient to what God has already revealed to you. And in obedience to what he has already shown you, and in growing in that obedience, he will reveal to you more. So you can't do division before you can add. You can't go, I don't want to add, I want to divide. I don't want to do simple math, I want to do physics. Well, okay, learn to add. You want to do physics? Learn to add. Learn to subtract. Then learn multiplication. Then learn division. Then learn. But it seems like everybody wants more and more and more when they have no intention of applying what they've already been taught. So it becomes this weird form of spiritual bulimia. Are you tracking with that? Where we come to church and we hear truth and then we go outside and vomit it up all over the ground before we can apply any of it. And then we just complain, oh, I'm hungry, I need something else to eat. Yeah, because you just vomited what I fed you all over the parking lot. So there seems to be, and this is, every time I've preached here, I've had people come up to me afterwards and just said something along these lines. Thank you just for the little bits of application. I knew that, I just didn't know really how to apply it. Thank you for that. And so it seems like there's this rash of bulimia here where you know all sorts of stuff that you have no idea how to apply. And I get that application could be the big bad wolf that blows the house down, where there's not just beautiful, biblical, solid, foundational truth in it. But at the end of the day, what he says here is, let us attain to what we know. Let us do what he's shown us to do. And then he'll move us on from there. Only let us live up to what we've already obtained. All right, let's keep going. Brothers, I can't imagine anybody saying this these days, but brothers, join in imitating me and keep your eyes on those who walk according to the example you have in us. The next piece would be this. I'll just, as best I can, say this. I think if you're running in a herd of morons, are you okay? I think that if you look around and you are running in a herd of morons, that might be why you're lagging some spiritually. Like, at some point, you have to become serious about your faith so that those around you, all right, those that you seek advice from, I see silly things happen all the time. I mean, you don't go and ask marriage advice to a dude that's been divorced 8 times. You don't ask spiritual advice from someone whose life is laden with sin. You don't find lost people and ask them about life decisions and take advice. That's not what we do here. We find those who are godly. We find those who have lived life well. We find those. See, there's this thing. I don't know if it happens here. But what happens in the United States is like all the 50 and 60-year-olds, they come over here and they talk about the old days and how they're glad they survived them. You know, remember when we had infants at the house and, oh, we just didn't sleep for months and thank God they're all married up now and they're gone. And remember that time we didn't have much money and we just had to share a bowl of soup and how great was that? And remember, and that's what they do. They come over here and they do this. And then all the young people get over here and they just kind of pool ignorance. And so all of them are like, God, life is always going to be this way. My kid hasn't slept in 3 days. I can't get my other kid to eat. He's going to die, and then they're going to arrest me, all right? And then, oh, man, work is so stressful, and I don't, is it ever going to end? And then there just doesn't seem to be any connection. So what ends up happening is the old men and women go off and chew cud until they die, and the young people are left regurgitating really dumb ideas that they have no framework to even understand our dumb ideas until they get older. So see, I have my own philosophy of living that if I can learn from your blood and not bleed, I'm king for that. So if you can sit me down and go, I tried that and lost a hand, then I will keep my hand. Thank you for losing yours. And go about my business. So I guess this is what I'm saying. At some point, those of you who are older have to humbly and graciously engage those who are younger. And those who are younger must humbly and graciously receive it and acknowledge that you're not as smart as you think you are. This will take the Holy Spirit to do some powerful work, as both groups tend to be proud. This is not a young person's problem, and it is not an old person's problem. But the scriptures clearly call us to one another. Yeah. Imitate those around you. It develops holy discontentment. I hope you're not hearing the word discontentment wrong, because in the end, it's just, I want my life to play out like that. Find those you can imitate. This goes right back up to what we talked at first. And then he has one more. And then I want to give you just a very simple two questions. And then I'll take questions from you. Okay? I'm going to skip down just for time's sake. And we'll pick it back up in verse 20. Well, I'll pick it up in 19. Their end is their destruction, and their God is their belly, and they glory in their shame with their minds set on earthly things. Here's the last piece. But our citizenship is in heaven, and from it we await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly bodies to be like his glorious body by the power that enables him even to subject all things to himself. I'll tell you why I do this here in a minute, but about twice a year, I go out to a very large cemetery in our area. And I take my Bible and my journal, and I look around at the headstones until I can find someone who died when they were my age. So this year, on my birthday, I went to the graveyard, and I found a headstone of a man who died when he was 35. And I sat down across from his grave, and I wrote his name down in my journal, and then I just started writing some questions about him. Like, I wonder if he had a wife. Because, you know, some people wait until later in life to get married. I went young. I went early. I wondered if he had any children. So I'm 35. I have 3 small children. I wonder how he died. I wonder if it was a disease or some sort of freak accident or... And I sat there for probably 3 or 4 hours, and here's what I pondered. Maybe this is my last year. I mean, why not, huh? I mean, 150,000 people died in the United States today. They were all different ages, all different backgrounds, all different religions, all different, some of them died in like crazy ways. Like they were very healthy people that were marathon runners and ate nothing but, you know, green salads and tofu, and they went for a 2-mile jog and then jogged into their garage and their hearts stopped and they died. And some people died of cancer at the age of 22, and some little children died, and old men died, and young men died, and there's something about that thought that keeps before me, in a very tangible way, the fact that I am going to die and stand in front of Jesus Christ and give an account for my life. It's coming for me. In fact, I am an hour and a half closer than I was when I walked in this room. And what he's saying here is that he keeps his eyes not on earthly things, but on heavenly things, which he considers his home. So if I could take all of this, like this entire talk, and I could push it into two questions, here are the two questions I would ask you. Here's how I believe spiritual formation to really play itself out in a very pragmatic way in your life. I think you have to find the answer to these two questions. Question one, what stirs your affections for Jesus Christ? What is it when you're around it, when you're near it, when you do it, when you stirs up your heart and stirs up your mind to Jesus Christ? So do you know why I go to the graveyard? My college roommate's dad died. He was actually a war hero, won the National Medal of Honor. They don't hand that thing out too often. He flew a helicopter in Vietnam, and they shot up his helicopter and shot him all up his legs. And so instead of going back for medical help, he actually made 2 more runs, getting soldiers out, won the Congressional Medal of Honor, died of cancer, so went to his funeral. And they fired off the 21-gun salute and folded the flag and gave it to him. And so after his funeral, I walked around the graveyard and saw a tombstone from someone who was my age and sat there and pondered his life. And, man, that pressed me into Jesus Christ. And so I went, I need to come to the graveyard every once in a while. That stirs my affections for Jesus Christ. The early mornings stir my affection for Jesus Christ. Some people are night owls. I am not. I would go to bed at 7:30 if I could. All right? My son gets that from me. I was looking for him the other day. I was like, "Reed, Reed, Reed." And I heard him yell from upstairs, "I'm in bed." Like, my boy. All right? And so I love early mornings. There's something about the cool quiet of early mornings that draws my heart towards the Lord. I like old books. Not silly books, like thick books. Like books that you read a paragraph and you go, "I have no idea what that man just said. I'll have to read that again." I like music that has emotion to it. Almost any style except country. See, I think country music is part of the fall. And I think that when Christ returns, he will destroy it and send it to hell where it belongs. Personal opinion, that's not in the text. That is complete conjecture, just an opinion of mine. Now, I like strong coffee. I like great meals, good food, good wine with good friends. There's something that stirs my affections. I'm not talking about McDonald's in your car. Please stop that. I can't even begin to tell you what that did to America. Don't do it, all right? Walk away. Just say no. Great food with great friends stirs my affections for Jesus Christ. It does. So what I want to do is fill my life with the things that stir my affections for Jesus Christ, and then I want to pay careful attention to things that rob me of my affection for Jesus Christ. Because here's the truth. After almost 20 years of following Jesus Christ, I'm not going to... The things that give my affection problems aren't like if I ran into a guy on the way out and he offered me heroin, I'm not going to go, should I do this? Can you give me a second, buddy? Pros, cons. Pros, the next hour and a half could be interesting. Let's go over to cons. I might lose my job. Could die. It's heroin, of course. I'm not going to do it. I'm just going to be like, bro, you're at Chandler on the Coast trying to sell me heroin? Crazy? What's wrong with you, all right? That's not tempting to me. I'm not going to stumble and fall. In fact, the things that haunt my spiritual formation more than anything else are morally neutral things. They're not things that could be called sinful in any vein, but they somehow rob me of my affections for Jesus Christ. So I'll give you some examples of that. I can't watch too much television. Now, I've never been the guy that goes, don't watch the demon box, all right? It'll make you, I never taught that way, never preached that way, don't believe that. But if I'm not careful, the telly will woo me to sleep. It'll, next thing you know, I'm laughing at things that the Lord calls wicked. So I just can't watch too much of it. I can't follow sports too closely. Isn't that sad? Here's why. I'll start to care. And nothing is more sad than a grown man who can be made depressed because a 22-year-old miskicked a ball. So I can't follow sports too closely. I could go on and on. And I'm not, like, I don't think your list might not look anything like mine. But I know I want to constantly look at my life and evaluate, does this stir my affections for Jesus Christ or does it rob it? And then here's the way I want to live. I want to fill my life with things that make me worship, love, and chase Jesus Christ. And I want to avoid what numbs that desire and passion.